Good morning. Before we get started today, I just wanted to take a moment to introduce a couple of guests that we have with us. You just heard Bradford Thompson improvise on Carol of the Bells on the piano. Back here behind him, we have Jarrell Strickland, who will be joining me for O Holy Night on the offertory. I just wanted to take a chance to introduce them. They were here for the concert last night, and they stuck around for this morning, so I just wanted to say thank you to them. Okay. Our opening hymn is number 213, Lift Up Your Heads, Ye Mighty Gates. Please rise as you're able and join us. Again, that's number 213 in your hymnal. Lift up your heads, ye mighty gates. Behold, the King of glory waits. The King of kings is drawing near. The Savior of the world is here. Fling wide the portals of your heart. Make it a temple set apart from earthly use. Adorned with prayer and love and joy. Redeemer, come, with us abide. Our hearts to thee we open wide. Let us thy inner presence feel, thy grace and love in us reveal. Thy Holy Spirit lead us on until the glorious goal is won. Eternal praise, eternal flame, be offered, Savior, to thy name.
Hear the reading from Isaiah 9, verses 6 through 7. For a child is born to us, a son is given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His government and its peace will never end. He will rule with fairness and justice from the throne of his ancestor David for all eternity. The passionate commitment of the Lord of Heaven's armies will make this happen. We light this candle as a symbol of the Prince of Peace. May the visitation of your Holy Spirit, O God, make us ready for the coming of Jesus, our hope and joy. O come, Emmanuel.
Let's thank Phil and Linda Terry for lighting our Advent candle for us today. Good morning. I want to welcome you to worship today. Great to see each and every one of you here on a beautiful Sunday morning, this fourth Sunday of Advent. I know we had a wonderful worship service yesterday, second annual Christmas at Latham that Tyler and his friends led. I was unable to be here and experience it, but I've heard so many people say wonderful things about it today. My wife Amy had surgery on Friday, and she was in the hospital on Friday night and got to come home yesterday about lunch, so I'm sorry that I missed it, but let's thank them for their effort yesterday. It was a beautiful service. I also want to welcome those that are worshiping with us on Facebook Live this morning. Thankful that you can be a part of this service, and remind you to check in with us. If you have prayer concerns or joys, you can share those with us in the comments section. And I do want to mention a few things, happening in the life of our church this week. Very busy time. Next Saturday night is Christmas Eve. We will have two candlelight communion services on Christmas Eve, one at 5 o'clock. There will be a nursery provided for the service at 5. We will also have a service at 9 o'clock. Won't be able to provide a nursery for that one, but I encouraged everybody in the early service. Great opportunity to bring your extended family members with you, and I know we have a number of those here with us this morning. Glad you're here. But also opportunity to invite neighbors. Share this on social media with people. We would love to have this sanctuary packed on Christmas Eve. So the next day, Sunday, is Christmas Day. We're going to do something a little different. We're going to have one combined worship service on Christmas. It will be at 10 a.m. It will be in here. The main sanctuary, it's going to be very informal, not going to have any Sunday school on that day. We're mainly going to be singing Christmas carols, short devotion, and then we'll get to go home and spend the day with our family. So just make sure that those two things are on your schedule for this week. You also will have seen, there's an insert in your bulletin today, has some updated financial information on the church. We've had a few people ask some questions, and Jeff Langout's going to come and share with us about that.
Well, hey, everybody, and Merry Christmas. Hey, I wanted to just give you some context of the insert that you have in the bulletin. So the first part there is the cash position, if you will, of our church at the end of November. And you might look at that and go, ooh, we're $61,000 behind. And I would say, well, don't go ooh, because December is normally a month where we have quite a few additional collections. And so historically, December is a very good month for the church. And so I don't think we'll be quite in that kind of a position by the time we get to the end of the year. And so I want to encourage you on that. The other thing is, you'll recall that we voted to leave the United Methodist Church, and those of us that voted to do that knew there was a bill associated with that. And we have written that check, and all things are done, and we're free and clear with all of that stuff. But there was an expense to that, and we all knew about that. And manna from heaven, $71,000 materialized to offset the cost of disaffiliation. But we still have another, you can see in the numbers there, we still have another, almost $60,000 that we really need to raise to cover the entire cost of disaffiliation. And so as Jackie and I pray for ourselves and our friends every day, which is, it's our job to, I pray that you will hear the Lord clearly and be obedient. Our job is obedience. His job is results. And just wanted to give you some context on the finances. Hey, thanks y'all very much, and Merry Christmas.
Jeff, we're going to watch a children's video this morning, but before we do, I shared this little story in the early service, and it has absolutely nothing to do with anything, maybe a little connection to Christmas, but I wanted to share, and you may have seen this story in the news. Many of us in different Christmas gatherings, whether it be family gatherings or an office party, play Dirty Santa. I think you know the gift-giving game that we play in a lot of different places, and I read this story yesterday about a lady in Kentucky who had gone to an office party, and they were supposed to bring $25 gifts for this Dirty Santa thing. And this one lady had gotten a $25 card from TJ Maxx. Well, the way the game works, somebody stole that gift from her. And so she had to decide what to do. And she decided to pick another person's gift. It was 5 scratch-off lottery cards. It's what she stole from another participant. Well, she scratched off the cards while she was there. And the first one, she won $50. So she more than covered. She doubled up on what the Christmas presents were supposed to be. But on the second card, she won $175,000. So be very careful as you're playing Dirty Santa this year. Choose very wisely. And on that note, let's watch this children's video.
Merry Christmas, Latham family. Some of our Latham kiddos wanted to extend some Christmas wishes to you.
Can you tell me who's on there?
Jesus,
that's right. Is it baby Jesus?
Uh-huh.
Can you show me where baby Jesus is on there? Hey, Caroline,
how's this look?
What do you want for Christmas?
American Girl doll bunk bed.
American Girl doll bunk bed?
Happy birthday, Jesus.
Hey, Benjamin, what do you want for Christmas?
I
airplane.
An airplane? Can you say Merry Christmas?
Merry Christmas.
Yeah.
Merry Christmas.
Want to tell me what you want for Christmas?
Merry Christmas.
Can you stand up against the wall for me? Can you smile and say Merry Christmas? Can you say Merry Christmas?
Say Merry Christmas, Miss Samantha.
Happy birthday, Jesus.
Samantha does a wonderful job with our children's ministry, and we appreciate her in that great video that she made for us. As we get ready to go to the Lord in prayer today, I do want to share several names with you and give you an opportunity to lift up names before we pray. Please continue praying for Gene Wells. Gene is under hospice care. I had an update from Carol yesterday. His condition is still basically the same, but they are very, very grateful for all the prayers that they are receiving. Encourage you to be faithful in praying for them. Also, pray for Lawrence Howard. Lawrence is still recovering. Thank you for your prayers for my wife. As I said, she came through her surgery well. And keep praying for her as she recovers. Continue to pray for Edith's mom, Lorraine, and her battle with cancer. And Rose Battle is awaiting some tests. And I think she gets the results of those this week. Please remember Rose. Does anybody else have any prayer concerns? Anything you want to lift up today? Jan? Jan Weaver's sister, Donna White. Anybody else? Well, let's go to the Lord. Gracious God, you are our Creator and our Redeemer, and we praise you. We thank you that in the fullness of time, you sent us your beloved Son. You reached out to us as your children. And you gave us hope. You gave us an opportunity to restore our broken relationship with you. And you offered us the gift of salvation through Christ. Lord, as we continue to make our way through this busy season, prepare our hearts and minds. Shape us more fully into the image and the example of Christ. Guide us by the light of your Holy Spirit. And give us eyes to see your glory all around us. I pray that you would set our hearts on fire to share your love and to spread your good news. Father, we believe that because of your great love for us, you want to bring healing and wholeness into our lives. And we also believe that our prayers make a difference. We lift those names before you today that have been mentioned. We lift the many names on our prayer concern list and other unspoken names on our heart today. According to your will that is good and pleasing and perfect, we ask that you would pour out your grace that is always sufficient. Father, you are the Prince of Peace. We ask that peace would come to this world. Help us, Lord, to be peacemakers in our homes and in this community. And now, Father, we join our voices together in praying the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I want to invite the ushers to come.
The stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till he appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh, hear the angel voices. Oh, night divine, oh, night when Christ was born. Oh, night divine, oh, night, oh, night divine. Truly taught us to love one another. His law is love, and his gospel is peace. Chains shall he break, for the slave is our brother, and in his name all oppression shall cease.
Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus raise we, let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord, oh, praise his name forever. Oh, night divine,
oh, night, oh, night divine, oh, night divine, oh, night, oh, night divine.
Stand with us.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
As we remain standing, let's affirm our faith together through the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Go ahead and be seated. And as we take our seats, go ahead and take out your hymnals and join us for number 219. I jumped ahead of myself. 218, It Came Upon a Midnight Clear. Again, that's number 218 in your hymnal. Please join us.
It came upon the midnight clear, that glorious song of old, from angels bending near the earth to touch their harps of gold. Peace on the earth, goodwill to men, from man's all-gracious King. The world in solemn stillness lay to hear the angels sing. Still through the cloven skies they come with peaceful wings unfurled, and still their heavenly music floats o'er all the weary world. Above its sad and lonely plains they bend on hovering wing, and ever o'er its babel sounds the blessed angel sings. And ye beneath life's crushing load, whose forms are bending low, who toil along the climbing way with painful steps and slow, look now for glad and golden hours come swiftly on the wing. Oh, rest beside the weary road and hear the angels sing. For lo, the days are hastening on, by prophets seen of old, when with the ever-circling years shall come the time foretold, when peace shall over all the earth its ancient splendors fling, and the whole world send back the song which now the angels sing.
Our music is always beautiful in this service, but I have to say it is especially so today. I think they deserve another round of applause. Our scripture reading today on this fourth Sunday of Advent comes from the Old Testament prophet Isaiah. This is Isaiah chapter 9, beginning in verse 2. Hear God's word. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in a land of deep darkness, a light will shine. You will enlarge the nation of Israel, and its people will rejoice. They will rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, and like warriors dividing the plunder. For you will break the yoke of their slavery and lift the heavy burden from their shoulders. You will break the oppressor's rod, just as you did when you destroyed the army of Midian. The boots of the warrior and the uniforms, bloodstained by war, will all be burned. They will be fuel for the fire. For a child is born to us, a son is given to us. The government will rest on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His government and its peace will never end. He will rule with fairness and justice from the throne of his ancestor David for all eternity. The passionate commitment of the Lord of Heaven's armies will make this happen. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Over the course of this Advent season, we have been talking about a different Christmas carol each week. And we've been thinking together about what these carols say to us about Christmas, but more importantly, what these beautiful songs say to us about Jesus. Now, the song we're focusing on today will be the song we sing for our closing hymn. And it is the beautiful carol, What Child Is This? You may know this. It was written by an Englishman in 1865, a man named William Dix. That makes it a really old song. But the melody, the tune we sing it to is older still. It's more than 500 years old. It's a tune called Greensleeves. I have no idea what the origin of that is, but it's very old. And I think the words and the music are both very beautiful. But when I think about this carol, what I am struck by more than anything else is the perspective from which William Dix wrote it. In this Christmas carol, the Christ child is clearly the focus. But William Dix wrote it as if someone has come to the manger scene with no idea who this child is. And the song goes on to try and answer this question, who is this baby? Who is this child? And I want to spend some time today thinking about what the answer to that question is. You know, it's been more than 2,000 years since that moment when Mary gave birth. And even though all of that time has passed by, I still believe countless people today struggle to come to grips with who Jesus really is. Now, we know that Jesus was born in a small village, a place called Bethlehem. We know that he was the child of ordinary parents, but we know almost nothing about the first 30 years of Jesus' life. We believe that he was a builder of some sort. And we believe that because of a Greek word, tekton, that describes someone who worked with wood or worked with stone. So Jesus might have been a carpenter, but it's just as plausible that he was a stonemason. But he was in the construction business. We also know that for 3 short years, Jesus traveled around Israel, teaching and preaching, doing miraculous things, healing people, setting people free from evil spirits. He gave the religious leaders of his day a hard time. He turned much of what they had been teaching upside down, and that got him in a lot of trouble. In time, it got him arrested and tortured and nailed to a cross. But thankfully for us, thankfully for the whole world, that was not the end of Jesus' story. From the very moment that Christ was born, this world has never been the same. His life and his death and his resurrection transformed everything. But as true as I believe that is, there's still tremendous debate. There's still all sorts of questions over who Jesus was and who Jesus is. Now, some people think of Jesus as simply being a gifted teacher, a really good preacher, somebody who went around and did some amazing things a long time ago. Other people have reduced Jesus to being a great moral example, somebody who was loving and kind and lived a really good life. And still some other people believe that Jesus was and is who the Bible tells us that he was. People believe that Jesus was and is who they have experienced him to be through the power of the Holy Spirit in their life. But you know, ultimately, we don't get to choose who Jesus is. This is something that's not up to us. In John's Gospel, John chapter 1, we find these very familiar words. Words that tell us something about the Christ child. John wrote that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Now, that's the ESV translation, which I like a lot, but I have to say that the way Eugene Peterson translates that last verse in the Message, I love even more. He said, the Word became flesh and blood, and it moved into the neighborhood. This baby, whose birth we are soon to celebrate again, was the eternal Word who became flesh and blood. God came to us in the form of a child who was both fully human and fully divine. And to be honest, that's hard to understand. It's hard to wrap our head around and comprehend what that fully means. But I think this passage of Scripture that I shared with you today from Isaiah chapter 9, it can help us to try and answer this all-important question. What child is this? Now, this passage was a prophecy about the coming Messiah. 700 years before Jesus was born, Isaiah told us that the people who walk in darkness will see a great light. And the light that Isaiah spoke of, the light that was coming, that light was coming in the form of a child. Isaiah said, for a child is born to us. A son is given to us. And then Isaiah goes on to share several names. Names that the Messiah would be called. And these names are important because they help us to understand who Jesus is. As parents, which we have a lot of parents, grandparents in this room. One of the important things that we get to do for our children is to give them a name. And sometimes that's easy. Sometimes it's straightforward. And sometimes it's a struggle. When Amy and I were trying to decide on the names of our three boys, it started out easier than it ended. We had some spirited debates about what those names were going to be. But it all ended well. But I think when it comes to names, that's not always the case. I've got some family examples that I will share with you. I had a great aunt that lived right down the road from me when we were growing up, an aunt that I really loved. She was my Aunt Harriet. But my Aunt Harriet's middle name was Etrulia. I've never heard of anybody named Etrulia before. She had another sister, my Aunt Dot. Dot's a straightforward name, but my Aunt Dot's real name was Dorthulia. They had an older brother who was known to everybody as J.P., but my Uncle J.P.'s full name was John Pink Green. I have no idea what my great-grandparents were thinking when they came up with all these names. Now, my grandpa, my mother's father, His given name was Irving. And he hated that name so much. When he was a young boy, he renamed himself. He wanted to be called Jack. And for the rest of his life, that's what people called him, was Jack. But even though my parents knew how much he hated that name, for some crazy reason, they decided to pass that name along to me. And I hate it just as much as he did. And so I've always just abbreviated it. If anybody ever asks me what my middle initial stands for, I always say it stands for my middle name. The story stops there. But names are important. Names say something about who we are. And before Jesus was ever born, Isaiah had given him four names, four titles. Isaiah said that the Messiah would be Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And each one of those names tells us something about Jesus. In the Old Testament, the idea of a Wonderful Counselor, it meant that someone possessed extraordinary wisdom. They could be completely trusted to give advice to people because they would never, ever lead them in the wrong direction. And that certainly applies to Jesus. Jesus was and is our ultimate advisor, our ultimate guide. Now, admittedly, his plans don't always make sense to us. Because his ways are higher than our ways. But I still believe that he wants to accomplish great things through our lives. Things sometimes that are beyond our comprehension. If we will simply allow him to guide us as our Wonderful Counselor. Now, Jesus is also known, as Isaiah tells us, as Mighty God, which speaks to his divine nature. That baby that was born in the manger is not just the Son of God, but he is also God the Son. The Nicene Creed says that Jesus is true God from true God. And the Hebrew word that is translated here is mighty. That word also meant strong. It meant all-powerful. And so when you think about these first two names given to the Messiah and how they relate to each other, as a Wonderful Counselor, Jesus is the perfect planner. And as Mighty God, he has the strength, he has the power to accomplish all of his plans. Now, another name that Isaiah used for the Messiah was the name Everlasting Father. And he uses that word everlasting because Jesus is before and above and beyond all time as we understand it. Jesus holds eternity in his hands. And he came to offer us the opportunity for eternal life. And everything that a good father should be, Jesus is for us. And because he's like a father to us, he cares for us as part of his family. He wants to be our father forever. You know, one of the greatest blessings that I've ever had in my life is the gift of being a father. I don't have the words in my vocabulary to express to you how blessed I am to be a father, how much I love and care for our three boys. They mean the world to me. And I would do anything that I possibly could to help them and protect them and provide for them. But you know, no matter how much I love them, no matter what I would do for them, I will always be an imperfect father. And the truth is, I won't always be here. And that's why it is so incredibly important that our three boys have a relationship with Jesus. so that they can know Him, so that they can experience His perfect love as their Father forever. Now, one last name that Isaiah gave to the Messiah was that He was the Prince of Peace. And a more literal translation of that Hebrew is the Prince whose coming brings peace. Now, Prince was a word now and then that speaks to somebody who is of high position. And the impact of this person of high position coming onto the scene was that they would bring about peace. And not just any kind of peace. Not the kind of peace when you conquer your enemy, but the kind of peace that doesn't make sense to us. The kind of peace that passes all understanding. Now, in the end, we might wonder why these four names that Isaiah called the Messiah should matter to us. Why is it even important for us today to try and answer this question? What child is this? Well, here's why I think it's important. It's important because we all get confused about life sometimes. We all make mistakes. We all lose our way. And so it's important for us to know that Jesus is our wonderful counselor. Now, we also have times when we feel weak, times when we're helpless, times when we don't know if our broken lives can ever change, and we feel hopeless. And so we need to be reminded that Jesus is a mighty God, and that with Him, nothing is impossible. At other times, we may feel forgotten or scared, or maybe we have never been blessed to have known a Father that truly loves and cares for us. And so it's really, really important that we remember that Jesus is an everlasting Father. Somebody who is always present in our life, who loves us sacrificially, who loves us unconditionally. Or maybe our life's been turned upside down. Maybe we're feeling frustrated and angry at the world, maybe even at God. And we need to experience Jesus as the Prince of Peace. We need to know that peace that passes understanding. We need that to be a reality for us. Now, this beautiful old Christmas carol, it asks us a very simple question. What child is this? I think Isaiah does a great job in trying to help us answer this question. But Isaiah also told us that this child is a gift from God. And gifts, they look really nice under our Christmas tree. But gifts are really useless unless we receive them, unless we open them, and unless we experience them. Now, God has given us a wonderful gift. And it's a gift that hasn't been wrapped up in fancy paper with a bow on top of it. Our gift came wrapped up in old strips of cloth. Our gift came in a baby in a manger that was surrounded by stinking livestock. And I pray today for us all that we would receive this gift, that we would experience Christ, that we would know Him for who He truly is, and that we would be willing to share this wonderful, wonderful gift with this fallen world around us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
For our closing hymn today, go ahead and rise and join us for number 219, What Child Is This? Please rise and join us. Again, that's number 219.
Child is this who lay to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch are keeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste to hing him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. Why lies he in such mean estate, where ox and ass are feeding? Good Christian, fear for sinners, hear the silent word is pleading. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. So bring him incense, myrrh, and rum, the peasant king to own him. The King of Kings salvation brings, let loving hearts enthrone him. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary.
Receive this benediction. Loving God, as we go forth, Holy Spirit, encourage us, empower us, lead us to share the gift of Christ, the Savior, your Son, with this world around us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said, amen.
Amen. Ready?
Go ahead.
People, look east, the time is near of the crowning of the year. Set your house fair as you are able. Trim the hearth and set the table. People, look east and sing today. Love, the guest is on the way.
Have a blessed week.